talked about the need to what I'll call articulate the value proposition. That is, distill the essence of your message in a way that's compelling. Okay, that's so value proposition is shorthand for that. It's known as unique sales proposition. People might know it as the elevator pitch or your talking points. There's an exercise that we're going to go through that will help you do that. That's session three. And we're going to have a guest speaker who just authored the most recently published guerrilla marketing book called Guerrilla Marketing Goes Green, Shel Horowitz. Next week, the session two, for those of you who are looking to be more of a resource, I've heard the term energy coach mentioned a few times. Whether you consider yourself an energy coach or an expert in your particular field, people look to you for information. They look to you to simplify things. So session two is going to be a presentation, a panel presentation that will help educate you, give you the tools and the resources that not necessarily that won't allow you necessarily to become an expert yourself, but direct people in an expert way. Okay, then session three, the value proposition, our exploration of how can we distill that our language in a way that's comfortable, compelling, that keeps us in a place of integrity so that it doesn't feel like we're falling into that old greenwashing trap. You just say you're green and it counts. And then finally, session four is we pull all this together, really get their pens to paper on action plan and deal with some specific tools and techniques, marketing tools and techniques, particularly leveraging the power of the internet, social media marketing, search engine marketing, getting your website amped up. Not necessarily found on page one in Google, not necessarily a design overhaul, but we have an expert whose last name happens to be Green and who happens to have the company named the Green Internet Group. He's on session four. That was quite by accident, I assure you. But he's a very well-known expert in the region on just that. And then I'm going to be also teaching you a technique called fusion marketing. That's one of the most powerful tools that you have available as a marketer, and it's about leveraging the power of relationships. That is, instead of trying to go at this alone and build a customer list at your own and do the outreach alone, where are the organizations, where are the individuals, the other businesses that you can partner with so that really, like fusion, which is, you know, if you think back to Chem 101, or Physics 101 is about the joining together of two nuclei for the simultaneous release of massive power, right? So you're one nuclei, your partner's another nuclei. How can you come together for explosive power? Okay, so that's really the flyover. The end result, of course, is a written action plan for yourself. You're going to have notes in these workbooks. You're going to be filling in these self-assessments. You're going to identify those areas of strength that you have to capitalize on and those areas of weakness that you either get to ignore happily because it's not critical to your execution or those where you really have to do some studying. Okay, so on the subject of expertise, and power. What I'd like to do is turn it over to Nancy, Nancy Hazard.
So what she's asked me to talk about is why I think green is an economic imperative. So hopefully you can integrate some of these things into your marketing efforts. A few weeks ago, I read in the Greenfield Recorder an article about how a group of people in California were approaching their state government and asking them to repeal the climate change legislation that had been passed, and to have it repealed until the unemployment rate dropped to 5.5%. And when I read that, I asked myself two questions. Why don't these people understand that green is the economic answer? And what is wrong with us? Why haven't we developed the messaging that we need so that those people understand that? For me, business as usual equals bankruptcy. And what do I mean by that? I mean from a national security perspective, from a imbalance of trade perspective, and also it's a disruption of our life, if in fact oil comes to an end. So how did I get there, and why am I so passionate about climate change solutions? So my personal history, which Nancy asked me to talk about. I don't talk about my personal history very much, so it's a little awkward. But my personal history is I grew up in New York City during the Cold War with the doom and disaster hanging over my head that life was going to come to an end at any moment because a nuclear bomb was going to be dropped. So I became a potter, and in the 70s, we had the oil embargo. And needless to say, that disrupted a lot of people's lives. And one of the things that sort of the aha moment for me here was looking at pottery. Now, one of the reasons that I chose to be a potter is because it was a traditional kind of way of making a living. It was something that everybody needed. People need pots to eat out of and stuff like that. But I realized the way that I was making pots made absolutely no sense. So what I was doing is I was in Leverett. The clay was being dug in, I don't know, China and God only knows where. It was dried, pulverized, put into a bag, and shipped to me. We're talking about soil, basically. Shipped to me, and then I make pots, and then I burn them with, I fire them with fossil fuels, and then it's questionable whether people really wanted them or not, because there are so many industrial products that are so much cheaper. So I did that for about 6 years and decided that that really wasn't what I wanted to do. So I became a builder. I became a builder for 15 years, and I was interested in building energy-efficient solar homes. And so, but after 15 years, I guess like you, Claire, I was really frustrated. A lot of my customers had no desire to build energy-efficient homes. And I was just building one house at a time. And clearly, that was not going to change the world. So I decided I had to do something different. I had no idea what I was going to do. I knew NESE, the Northeast Sustainable Energy Association, because they offer so many courses in builders, and I've been going to their conferences for many years. So I volunteered in 1989 for the Tour de Seoul. And I, there was this is an event which was actually based on an event which is in Europe. And the idea was to demonstrate that sunlight could drive our transportation systems, or at least our cars. And that was a huge aha moment for me. So I knew that we could heat our homes with solar and with energy efficiency, although the idea of a zero net energy building, of course, hadn't even penetrated our brains. And I got really intrigued with the idea of a car because, and why I all of a sudden shifted from buildings to cars. And I actually hate cars, so I can't believe that I shifted there, but I did. And but the thing about a car is that a car, there's only like a handful of manufacturers of cars, as opposed to builders. There's hundreds of thousands of builders. So if you could convince people that they wanted a different appliance, then the car companies would buy it. Naive that I was. So anyway, that was my thinking at the time. And I worked on that for about 18 years, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. And you guys probably know the answer to this question, but I'm a numbers person, and I'm always told that numbers do not change people, that it's something much more fundamental that change people. However, I'm a numbers person, so I have to put numbers out there. And I learned a lot of numbers being a Tour de Seoul person. So one of the things I sometimes do is I turn that around into a question. So I ask people, you know, do you know? And one of the questions that I often use is, do you know how much, what percentage of the oil the United States owns of the oil reserves? Now, probably a bunch of you know the answer to that question. What do you think? You know the answer, don't you?
Of all the oil reserves?
Yeah, all the oil reserves in the world. What percentage do we have? Four, you think? Anybody else?
10,
okay. Yeah, usually I get answers anywhere between 10 and 60%. But the answer is
two.
So how much drilling offshore or wherever is going to help us, right? It's just not going to help us, particularly from an economic perspective. So what do we do with the Tour de Seoul, and kind of what were some of the things that I learned from that? We had an idea. We wanted to change the automobile to run on sunlight, zero oil, and later we articulated zero carbon when we understood climate change a little more. We didn't have any money, but I fortunately met a PR guy whose name was Jack Rowe, and he said, spend your money on PR, not on advertising. And we hired him the first year. It was a real gift for $2,000. Now, $2,000 was the largest line item in our budget. So this was a huge commitment on our part. But I certainly don't regret any penny of that. And we worked with him for, I worked with him for over a dozen years. So we created a road rally event that was a competition. So we created news. And he kept chastising me that we needed one winner, and we always had 10 winners. And it was always kind of, our scoring system was very complicated and messy. But nevertheless, we created news, and the event grew from 6 cars to 50 cars and then kind of shrank again. But in our better years, we were reaching over 100 million people, and we had over 400 news articles and TV. We were in the TV news and stuff. So we were quite successful in that respect. Now, that media outreach and that visibility drew all kinds of people to us, and particularly in people who participated with us. So the Department of Energy, who, by the way, their mission is to get us off oil, off foreign oil. That was their mission. That's why they were created. Utility companies, auto companies, engineering people, students, college, universities, and high schools. And all of those people became our spokespeople. And the media loves people who are enthusiastic and who, you know, speak with passion. So so that's something for you guys when you have customers, that they could become your spokespeople. And then I want to say that the other thing I learned is the power of local media. And I'm sure you guys are going to be talking about this, you know, these next couple of times. But in what my PR guy told me is that more people believe local news than believe the national news. And we have fabulous media in the Valley, so take advantage of it. I'm presently working on the Greening Greenfield campaign. And so I'm now working on the local level for the first time. And again, I've learned a lot about sort of what to do, what not to do. And I'll just share a few little details with you. About a year after we started, the campaign's been going for 3 years. The first year after we had done it, Greenfield Community College person, Kathy Vranos, who teaches the business and marketing class, asked if her students could do could look at our business and practice with us. And we said, that'd be great. So they did this whole study. They talked to people in the community, all this stuff. And we learned a bunch of things. But the two things I want to share with you is money is the motivator. Not a big surprise, but nevertheless. And when they asked also, well, when you do these particular behavior patterns, you know, like reduce the amount of miles you drive or lower your thermostat or something, or insulate your house, does that have anything to do with the environment? The answer was no, has nothing to do with the environment. And they even said so far as to say, environmentalism is not for us, it's only for the rich people. The other thing that we learned is we've been doing this for a year, and very few people knew about the campaign. So we had a logo, we had been doing press releases, we had been doing events, we had posters, all that stuff. Nobody really knew about it. We also did an energy audit, and we discovered in 2008 that the entire community, 19,000 of us, spent $86 million on energy in 1 year, $86 million. And of that, $67 million went out of the community to pay for the product that we were using. The rest of the money went to the people who, you know, made the pipes and the you know, electric lines and stuff like that. 19,000 people spent $86 million on energy, and of that, $67 million left our community. So I thought, oh my God, just think of all the business people in Greenfield, that they have to bring a hell of a lot of money into Greenfield just for us to stay even. And this is just a microcosm of what's happening to our country as a whole as we ship all of our money out of this country. Bankruptcy. The town started looking at their energy more closely, and also the Green Greenfield Energy Committee, the citizen group, decided to create a campaign called the 10% Challenge. if you've seen our signs around town, they say something like saving energy equals saving money, or vice versa. I forget which goes first. But in any case, the equation between the two. We had a long discussion about whether we should put environment and climate change on that sign. And a lot of people wanted to do that. We decided not to. We said, well, you know, the GCC study said money's the motivator. We got to go with that. So we went with that. So 6 months after we launched that campaign, the center school sixth graders wanted to do a project. And they interviewed people on the street and asked a bunch of questions. And one of the questions they asked was, how many of you know about this? And 80% of the people said they knew about the 10% challenge. Well, you know, nobody knew about the Green and Greenfield campaign. So the question is, you know, what were the things that we had done that had made it visible? Well, one of the things we had done, we'd been inspired. I talked to someone who talked to me about the Cuba literacy campaign. And in Cuba, what they did is they had flags. And if you became part of that campaign, you got a flag. Everybody wanted a flag. They were desperate for those flags. And the level of literacy in Cuba also is amazing. Mm-hmm. It was a hugely successful campaign. So I look back on sort of history, maybe not 100 years, but, you know, close to that. And some of the questions that come to mind are, where would the world be today if in the 50s, we had chosen to invest in renewables instead of in nuclear power? That was a watershed moment for the world in looking back at it. The way it was sold to us is it was the best economic choice. Too cheap to meter. Then, more recently, when we became involved in the Iraq War, the first thing that came to my mind was bankruptcy. This is, you know, a recipe for bankruptcy. The 10% challenge. Yeah, I didn't explain what that was. So the 10% challenge was for 10% of the households. So there's 8,000 households in Greenfield. So 800 households would sign on to agree to lower their energy use by 10% by the end of 2010. We're about 400 right now. So we're getting there. So we have these lawn signs everywhere. And there was this big thing about, would we give the lawn signs away for free, or would we ask people to pay for them? And I'm the sort of the treasurer, and I said, well, you know, if they agree to do this, ask them for the $5, what the hell, it's not a big deal. And everyone says, no, you just need to give it away. And so I kept saying, you know, until I did tabling. Everybody came to the table, they all wanted the sign, they were all excited, they wanted to get. And I said to some, you know, well, you know, would you be willing to give us $5 for that sign? Smile went off their face, they weren't interested, you know, the whole experience. And so this, again, a lot of, you know, sampling a lot of things, that if you give someone something, they now have an obligation to do something for you. Yeah. So this may not be so bad, because it's hard for us to track this stuff, but the question is, so every time they see their sign, they remember that they receive that for free. Mm-hmm. So hopefully that means they're going to be more highly motivated to actually reduce their energy use. Yeah. Who knows? We'll see. And maybe they'll even give us some money someday down the pike. Yeah. We're now doing a survey with some money that CET has actually, Course Foundation money, and it just went out, I think, yesterday or earlier this week to the people that have signed on, to try to get a sense of our laundry list of things they could do, whether they're doing them or not, and whether they did them before, whether it's a new action or, but it's yeah. If you got any ideas of how to track this, we could sure use that. Another thing that we have done is we've created a Green Hero campaign, so that when we hear stories, we have an agreement with the Greenfield Recorder that every month we can have a copy on the Green Page. And so we have so that's one way that we're recognizing those people. Uh-huh. And so, I don't know, it's sort of it's a work in progress.
Right.
I guess that's, you know, I'm hoping to learn some of those things. Yes?
Why can't you measure energy use? I do all the time, I look at a meter.
It's a good question. We actually created a very simple Excel spreadsheet that people could put in their utility use, and it converted it, whatever. And we even had some workshops to try to, you know, hold their hands while they brought their energy bills to the table and whatever, and we analyzed it, and we have, so far we have had not had good luck.
Aren't they developing a system of smart metering where, I think out in California, they're developing systems so that they can monitor the energy usage as it as the upgrades and changes to the systems are implemented, and it's web-based so that the communities can see if they invest in alternative sustainable energy that they can actually go online and get a report on how much energy they're saving. I think they're developing those systems.
Well, I don't know about that particular one, but that's a good example of how I love to do research and find out what other people are doing.
Yeah.
Because people are doing fabulous stuff, not only in this country, but in other countries,
right.
Just fabulous stuff. And we need to learn about that, and we need to figure out how to bring that into our efforts here.
Community Action, when they do audits for people, they have them sign a waiver that allows them, Community Action, to then access their bills. And you know, they go steps further beyond this. They get into other things, but it maybe these people should allow you to be able to access their electric bills. You know,
that's a great
all of
idea.
Staff.
Well, like at least one person, so that you can at least see. So now we have a baseline before
mm-hmm.
you started, and now we can monitor as you go through this.
It's a great idea.
Control.
Thank you. Other suggestions how I can make this better?
We also have to track the oil or gas delivery.
Yeah, but that's a much easier one. The oil companies themselves track
mm-hmm.
that, and you can get those records easily.
Well, but
if you
by
have
law,
permission.
If you
so,
have the permission
yeah.
by
right.
the customer.
But even the customer should be able to make
mm-hmm.
that one phone call.
This whole issue of energy and why it's important is that, as I keep saying, it's dollars, it's dollars, it's dollars. It's whether it's bankruptcy for this country, and it's and we need to really, we need to raise that consciousness level, because people are not, I mean, as you were saying, Claire, they're not ready to act, and we need to get them to that point where they're ready to take this seriously. And in fact, there's a woman that I met in England who had the job of, she owned a PR firm, and she was hired by the British government to do a marketing campaign around climate change and to get people concerned. And in 2 years, she moved the entire country, from being 20% concerned to being 80% concerned. It was just remarkable. Now, there is that question of, now that the 80% are concerned, are they actually going to do something so that it actually reduces? And that's where the numbers come in, and they're really important. And so we can't not measure the fact that people are actually doing, following through with their commitments. Because as we all know, we need to reduce 80% at least, and probably more in the next bunch of years. And the UK has been a leader in this for many, many years. So for example, they were the first government to come forward and say, we have to reduce our climate change emissions by 60%, and then they changed to 70%. But over 10 years ago, about 10 years ago, they made that statement and that commitment. And now you're seeing that the fruits of that through the transition towns and lots of other activities. So I'm thrilled that you're here and that we're all working together towards this goal. Thank you.